Hi there. In this tutorial, I'm going to talk through a number of the elements of how I created this short bit of fun. As you can see, it's an animation. I've got this Tesla, I think it's a Roadster. I've got the Starman in the middle, and the whole thing is obviously rotating and the camera's rotating with it to give the background the movement that we can see. So I'll just cover a number of the main elements on how this was created. For my Patreon patrons, I will upload all the models from this animation just to save you a bit of time. But obviously, all I've really done is just very roughly modeled things. It's by no means a perfect car model. If I just move around to here, so we can see, I just used a background image of a Tesla Roadster. If I go to another layer, and this was one of the main images that I used. I've loaded that as a background image there. You just turn on background images and then you just load it in. You can say whether you want it behind your model or in front of it. And you can adjust the opacity of it as well. And you can flip it round whichever direction you want. You can even load different views for different angles. So I just basically drew a flat plane, the shape of the car, and then extruded it. So just very briefly, this is by no means the only or even the best way to do it. But it's a way, and it's just a simple way to do it. So we can take these two points out to here, then just take this one down. Because to begin with, you're just really roughly modeling it. And you've got to bear in mind that some of these faces aren't as close to the camera as the ones in the middle here. But you're just roughing out the shape. So this tutorial isn't going to go into a lot of detail on modeling. And there are many different ways of doing this sort of thing. But I find if you just want a quick and rough model, for me, this is a quick and dirty way to do it, as it were, and it gets the job done reasonably quickly. Unsurprisingly, time is an important factor when you're doing this sort of stuff. So that's a rough shape for the car, at least the eye spots on the car. I'll just add a bit of geometry in the middle there. And now select all the vertices, extrude, and it doesn't really matter which direction, but extrude in a direction. And we're going to obviously have to change some of the geometry quite a bit in a minute. I'm going to go to face select mode, unselect everything, and then just select all of these faces in here. Make sure they're the only ones selected, then X and delete faces. You'll notice that our center point is right there on that edge. So we can go to modifiers and we can add a mirror modifier, and we need to mirror on the Z axis in this case. So you can see now we've only got to really shape one side of the car and the other side will shape with it. At this point, it's useful to have a different view of the car top down, but I couldn't find one of those. So I had to sort of guesstimate to some extent. And as I say, I'm not going to go into a lot of detail on the modeling here, just really showing the principle of how I did that. And obviously we need some extra geometry for where we're going to cut out the wheel arches. So I can just take away those two vertices, which gives us a hole. And that's obviously where the wheels could go. Whether you fill that in is up to you. Depends on whether it's going to be visible, really. I think I did end up filling it in. And obviously you need to modify the shape a little bit in order to get it more rounded and take that in. And then add a subdivision surface and you start to get a car shape. If we select smooth, already we've got something approximating a sort of blocky car. I can turn off my background image for the moment. And obviously you've got to get a good idea of what the shape of the car is. And a useful function when you're modeling things like this, where you need lots of smooth surfaces. And I'll add some extra geometry at this point just to help demonstrate this function, is smoothing it out. So you can see when I added that extra geometry, it emphasized the square blockiness of these edges, which on the actual Tesla is not as blocky as that. So if you've modeled this way, you will end up with shapes like that. Here's a simple way to smooth them out. So whether you select a line or otherwise, in fact, we'll select that whole set of vertices and then Control Plus just to select some more nearby. Then under the tool settings, you should find Smooth Vertex. If you click that, you'll notice that's actually rounding it off, but it's actually changing the shape of the vertices, whereas the subdivision surface just adds new vertices that give you a smoother look. This is actually changing the vertices that are there. And you notice I'm deselecting some because they will also sort of stretch and pull in vertices. So if we smooth vertices again, and we're starting to get a smoother shape now. So you can do that sort of thing. And certainly you don't have to just do it as multiple presses the way I did. If I did come away from the edges again, because otherwise it will tend to tear these edges back. But if I smooth the vertices again there, you'll notice we get repeats and the amount of smoothing. So we could put that up to say 4. And then every time we say smooth vertex, that will do 4. Now you notice that's actually gone quite square again. So we'll undo that. So going back to our other model, this is the model of the car. Once you see it like this, you can see it's not perfect, but I was only really concerned with getting it to look reasonably accurate to the Roadster that was launched into space, obviously. So one of the other things you will want to do is to add sort of seams like this where the doors are. So a way to do that is to add some extra vertices. And if you just do it in a very crude way, it will cause some other issues. I've done this car with a roof on there. I later on removed the roof, but add some extra vertices either side of a line of vertices like this. Then where I want the seam to be, I've just selected that ring of vertices, that set of vertices. I'm going to pull it in slightly. I can shrink it slightly and pull it in towards the center slightly. Bring up the right-hand menu with N, scroll to the top, and maximize mean crease. And now if we look, even with the subdivision surface on, we've got a little crease down the side there. And then that's how basically you can form these creases here without actually making them separate pieces of geometry. Now, if you're properly modeling a car, you'd probably model these pieces separately, because that's how a car is made, and it will work much better, and it'll actually be easier to some degree. So a little bit about some of the materials now. Open another window at the top there. We'll go to the node editor, and we'll start with the main sort of paint material that I did. Again, this was really about just getting a lot of things together relatively quickly. I wanted to get the video out reasonably soon after the launch. So we'll just say new material. Again, of course, this is all in cycles. So I decided to use the principled shader, which is a relatively new shader in Blender. So I've removed the diffuse. I'm going to add a shader, which is the principled shader. I'm not completely convinced by this shader yet for photorealistic renders or anything approaching photorealistic renders, but it may just be I haven't had enough practice yet. So I decided I wanted a red car, and you can see with the principled shader, the idea of it is that it's an Uber shader. It's got lots of other shaders, as it were, embedded inside it, so that you've got a lot of functions that you would normally have to put new shaders in for already as part of the one shader. So I left it at multi-scatter and I chose a red base color, quite a dark base color, and take the output of that, of course, into the surface. So I'm just gonna add a sun lamp into this layer just so we can see what's going on, and we'll go to rendered view. So that's what it looks like at the moment, just a bright red color. For car paint, generally, I wouldn't think there'd be any need for a subsurface scatter, so I left that as naught. It is quite a metallic looking paint, I think, so I set that up at 0.98. All a little bit arbitrary, but you can see the difference. If I set that back to zero, you can see it's just like an emulsion paint on a wall or something. If I put it up at one, it is quite metallic, so I just set it back from that slightly at 0.98. The specular, if I go down to zero, or go up to maximum, you can see it doesn't make a huge difference. It gives you a sort of slight sheen, so I think I left that at about 0.3. And then you can have a specular tint. So this is really just a specular is the highlights, the non-reflective highlights. So it's reflected light, but it's slightly diffused reflected light. So obviously the roughness then, I set that down so it was quite shiny. So I set that down to 0.1. So now you can see we've got a very shiny paint. It's actually quite hard to see with a shiny paint, which is why I'm angling it around a little bit. I left anisotropic at zero. Probably with a real car metallic paint, you might want to play around with that. And that's anisotropic rotation. So anisotropy just affects light, whether it's light that's transmitted through a scattering volumetric or whether it's light reflected off a surface. It's the light reflects differentially depending on the angle that the object is relative to the viewer, and also the rotation of the object. So if you imagine at the bottom of an aluminium saucepan, which has been obviously ground in a circular direction, any reflections of light like this will form a sort of pattern. It'll form a semicircle on the bottom of that saucepan, and the amount of it is set by the depth of the anisotropic. And the rotation, if it's not a circle, it could just be straight lines, so it could be brushed aluminium. The rotation of it, the angle of it on the surface, is set by this one. But again, as I said, I didn't bother with that. So then we've got sheen. Not a huge difference. I just left that at about the middle somewhere. And again, sheen tint. I left that quite low. Clear coat. Now, most cars do have a clear coat, so I guess this simulates a sort of secondary set of reflections on the surface. And I set that up at maximum. These are very subtle effects. I can only just see them firsthand, so they may or may not be coming through, and you really just need to give them a try. And obviously the clear coat is, as the name suggests, a clear coat, so the index of refraction is going to affect how that works. And I just left that at 1.45 and transmission at zero, and that's all I did for the paint. Now, you could obviously spend a lot more time and a lot more energy on getting a more realistic paint if that's what you're looking for. If I add some more light into the scene, so I'm just going to add a plane and I'm just going to put an emission on it, and that just gives us some more light to reflect off the car. So there you go, that's my very, very rough metallic car paint. And I used similar effects for most of the other elements of it. But for the glass, I needed to do something slightly different. So let's just select a few faces here. Obviously, it wouldn't be quite like that. I modeled the glass a little more than this, but let's just select those faces and call those glass. And at the moment, they've got our body material. So I'll click the plus here to add a new material, say new, and we'll call this glass. And I'll assign the material there. But before I do that, I'm going to give the body a color in the viewport so we can see what's assigned to where. Then I'm going to go to the glass and give that a bluish color and assign that. So now you can see we've got this area assigned to glass. So go to rendered view now, and it's just a white material at the moment. So I'll remove the diffuse, and the obvious thing to do is to add the glass shader. So I can connect that into the surface, and there it is. And I think what I'm going to also do is just cut away some of the body just to help us see what's going on. Now we can look through the glass, but essentially it's still very dark. I think I'm going to move my lights a little bit. Let's have the sun shining down in a little bit, and let's have this lamp up here somewhere now. So one of the problems is that it will introduce a lot more noise, and obviously it does give you a lot of magnifying effects, as it were. And the glass in a windshield is usually pretty thin, so for obvious reasons it doesn't really have much of a magnifying glass type effect. I'm going to put just a light colored block inside the car just to help us see what's happening. So there, first of all, you can see there's very little of the sunlight reaching that block through the window, first of all. It's now shining straight in through that window. So you can see on the right hand side there, that's where the sun is shining through. And yet, if you look in here, most of the light is stopped. The glass itself is obviously infinitely thin because it's only just a thin surface at the moment, and yet it's cutting out most of the light. So let's set the IOR down to 1. Even now, it's just cutting most of the light out. Let's set it to multi-scatter or even sharp. And obviously, even if we set it down to less than 1, it's still not quite right. So I found glass shader, certainly for very thin pieces of glass that should act like a window, to be less than satisfactory for most purposes, especially if the glass is not completely flat. So I didn't use that. I used a much simpler system. So I added an add shader, and we'll connect that into our surface. I added glossy shader, because obviously the glass needs to be shiny. And I used my usual Ashcombe & Shirley. And I added a transparent shader into the other side. Roughness I set to 0, so it's completely shiny. You could give it a little bit of specular by going 0.001 maybe, and then that just increases the roughness of the glass slightly. It means it distorts things a little bit, but I left it at 0. I also had left the color at slightly darker than full white for the reflection. And now you can see it's what you would expect to see through a car window. You wouldn't expect it to be distorting what's inside, even on the curved surfaces, very much. Because if it did, then obviously it would cause you problems when you're driving. You can play around with it. You could, for example, vary the mix based on the angle of the light using a layer-weight node, but for my purposes I found this was sufficient. So next, the planet. So that's the Earth, obviously. So just a straightforward icosphere. I decided to use an icosphere because they UV unwrap better than a UV sphere, really. Or for some things they do, anyway. So just scaled it up. Obviously, you could scale it to an appropriate size, but then your model would be very, very big. But at the same time, it needs to be far enough away and big enough that the size looks about right, but it doesn't cast too much in the way of light or shadow on the car, other than what it should. And add a subdivision surface, quite a few levels, and set it to smooth shading. You can spend a lot of time trying to map images to spheres, and if you get the right image, it's pretty straightforward. You can just use a UV sphere, use UV unwrapping, you'll get a slightly strange looking UV map, but you should be able to find images of the Earth that will map to that directly. I didn't spend a lot of time looking, so I just ended up with a very simple image. And after all, for the short duration of my animation, I didn't need to see very much of the Earth's surface. So this is the image I ended up with. The only thing I would say is you really want a fairly high resolution image. So this is quite a large image, and you can see I can zoom in quite a long way before it starts to become blocky. Because this is going to be quite large, so if you use a lower resolution image, you'll see it. So this is quite important. So now, if I just normally UV unwrap this, sphere unwrap it for example, it's not going to look quite right. So if I go to material, and then come over here and just add an image, which is the image of the Earth, you can see that's not quite right. It's all stretched. And even if we are only looking at it, from a specific angle just doesn't look right, does it? So what I decided to do, I'll just put my camera in the scene and we'll look from the camera. So this car's the other way around. So there's my camera. So I'm just gonna move the Earth to the other side so that when looking through my camera, I can see it, scale it down a little bit. And then what I'm gonna do is just say U project from view bounds. And now you can see it maps quite well. And all I now need to do is just scale this UV map so that the texture fills what we can see, because we're never gonna see any other part of that model. So now you can see the mapping is pretty good. Rotate it around however you wish, and it looks fine. Of course, as soon as we scan around it, you can see it's all distorted. But that doesn't matter because we're never gonna see that. The important thing is we've got the majority of our data from our image visible in the camera as the Earth appears to move past it. So now if we go to rendered view, because we've got the sun in a slightly different place, we've actually got some shadow on the Earth. So I'm gonna just move the sun now where I had it, which was somewhere over here. I'm gonna remove that object now, roughly opposite the camera, so that the sun was pretty much full on the Earth. And there we go. So I did put a bit more work into the material for the Earth. So here's our image texture. I decided it needed to be darkened slightly or stretched a little bit in terms of its dynamics. So I added a gamma node and I set that at about 1.2. And you just see, just I think looks better if I mute that node. It looks a bit too bright, unmute it. And now the blues are a richer blue, the greens are a richer green. It just looks better to me. I even added a brightness and contrast node, but I only adjusted the contrast by 0.005. Very, very subtle, but again, just sort of enhancing that detail. I felt this was an important element of the scene. And finally, a hue saturation node, and I just turned the saturation down ever so slightly because I felt it had got a bit high with these two nodes. So that's 0.9. So the next thing I did was add a mix shader. Drop that in there. I added a layer weight node from the inputs and took the facing output into the control on the mix shader. I also added a glossy set to Ashkman Shirley and put that on the other side of the mix shader. So we've got a bit of glossy on the Earth now. And I left the roughness at about default, but I set the blend on the layer weight node to a very low value of 0.05. Now at the moment it's not doing a huge amount, just sending a straightforward number out. So it's just giving us a bit of a sheen. So now I added a color ramp and I took the image into the input on that color ramp. You hold shift down and then left click and draw the mouse down. You can add an extra little joining point there. And now I add a bump node under vector bump. Take the color output from that color ramp into the height input on the bump node. Then take the output of that bump node. You can see we've got identical colored node inputs on these nodes over here. So into the layer weight node, the diffuse node, and the glossy. And again, we can join all those together, which just makes things a bit easier. And the reason for doing that was to try to give a little bit of visibility to these clouds, because clouds often have shadows. So they often do seem to stand up slightly from the surface of the Earth when you look at satellite images. So if I take the diffuse out, you can actually see we've now got a surface visible that is primarily the clouds. I take this output and put it into our diffuse and reconnect that. You can see what that's seeing. So the clouds are the whitest thing in there. But what you then need to do is obviously adjust the color ramp slightly. So that's removed most of the darker shades and then take off a little from the top, as it were. And now we're just showing the clouds. Take that out of there and put our hue saturation node back in. And the only thing you then need to adjust is how extreme the bump is. So we can set this up a little bit. And I had that set to about a distance of 0.4. And it'll vary depending on how close you are. And I think that actually may be a little bit too much. So we can soften it a little bit by going to B-spline and then come down on the distance, something like that. So it's just a subtle effect of some shadows to one side of the clouds. It just gives you that feeling that they're a little bit higher than the rest of the sphere. And I'm setting layer weight to 0.025. You could even add an extra layer to the Earth to give more realism to the edge. There's a lot you can do, but I felt that was sufficient for the brief time that it was visible. Remember, it's never actually stationary and it's just moving through the scene very quickly. So the next thing is our Starman inside the vehicle. So here's the one I modeled. It's very basic, as you can see. It still took a little while to model, as human figures often do. So you can start with your box, add some geometry to it, and then just start modeling. As it turned out, I didn't even need his legs, so I needn't have modeled all of that. And very much like the car, because we only need half of the model once you've got it started, and I did each of these on a different layer. Once you've got it started, you can then take away half of it and add a mirror modifier. So he's a bit of a robot at the moment. And because I wasn't doing a full human model, I didn't worry too much about the geometry. So just very crudely box modeling here. And obviously you can put as much time and effort into it as you want to. And then add a subdivision surface and it starts to get better. One of the things we will need to do is obviously smooth this off. So what you may want to have done is actually smooth that cube into a sphere at the beginning. But again, we can use our smooth vertices. I forgot I had 5 on that already. And if we turn on clipping here, we seem to have a slight error there. So let's just remove those vertices. There we go. So it's getting better. It's looking a little bit less cubic. Obviously, we can bring him in a little bit there. And so on. The materials on him, very similar to those that I did on the car. And obviously, I decided he needed to have a slight reclining posture. But because I wanted his arms to be doing different things, I needed to apply the mirror modifier. So I'm going to do that now. We'll just give him a basic white texture, but we'll give him a rough sort of mask. Like that. So I put these in different layers. What you do is up to you. Because I've done my car the other way around, we're going to put him this way around. So this one's obviously a European SpaceX man. And drop him into the car, something like that. Maybe make him a little smaller. And I think possibly we can bring the back of the car forward a little bit. And obviously I modeled a steering wheel in there as well. So the next thing we need to do is actually make him movable. So I'm going to move him to a new layer now. I'm going to put him over here. And let's go and see what he's up to. So in this case, we're going to animate his right arm and his head. So I'm going to put my cursor there and I'm going to add an armature, which is a single bone. I'm going to come over to here to the bone properties and I'm going to select X-ray so that I can see it all the time. It doesn't matter whether it's behind him or in front of him, I'll be able to see it. So this is the root bone. This is the one that will control the rotation of his entire body. So we're going to put that about there. It's got a bit of rotation on him, so let's just amend that. Okay. So in edit mode, I selected the top part of that bone and I'm extruding one out. So that's E, and extruding it down and make sure that roughly follows the alignment of his arm, extruding it forward. And if you want his wrist to be able to move, we need another one there as well. Just going to look from above just to correct the angle of those particular bones. That looks pretty good. Now I don't need them for the other one unless you want to be able to move that other arm or reposition it slightly. But I did want to move his head. So for this one, I'm going to put a neck bone in and then a head bone. And then look from the side and let's just make sure it's reasonably well seated within the head. So I'm now going to move that armature to a new layer just so that I can see the armature easily on its own. So if we go into pose mode now with the armature selected and I select, say, that bone there, press G, all it does is rotate around. Whereas what I really want it to do is to move the way an arm moves. So if I go up to here, which is bone constraints, add a constraint and say inverse kinematics. And now I press G, and you can see the whole armature moves in order to accommodate that. Now I don't necessarily want the whole armature to move if I'm pulling his arm. So what if I affect chain length? I'm going to select that to 1, and now I press G. Nothing really happens. But if I go to 2, now his forearm moves along with it. I'd like his upper arm to move as well, so I go to 3. Now you can see his whole arm moves along with that. If I go to 4, it will remove his shoulder as well, but I probably don't really want his shoulder to be moving at the moment, even though there are circumstances where you might. So the only thing I really want to be moving is his arm and hand and so on. Now the same for the head. Again, G, nothing moving with it at the moment, so I'll add the inverse kinematics. Again, it's moving the whole body. Again, you might want that, but let's just try 2. And you can see now it's just his neck moving. If I just do rotation, it doesn't even move that. So going back to object mode, and we'll bring up the layer with a man in as well. Select our Starman, select our armature, control P, and say set parent to armature with automatic weights. Now select the armature on its own, go to pose mode, and let's see how that did. Sometimes it will have done very well, and sometimes it won't. So it's not bad, it's moving his body a little bit, and I'll show you how to fix that. And you can see the two with the IK constraints on are actually illuminated. So moving his head, that for some reason that's moving his other arm as well. So if we select our model now and we go to weight paint, depending on which bone of the armature we have selected, will show you how the model is affecting it. So in terms of that head bone, that's fine. But I noticed that was moving as well, and that's because we were moving the neck bone as well. And now you can see it's not so clear. So up here we can select subtract, and we can subtract the influence down here. And if need be, we can add some influence just for the neck, but there's not very many vertices up there, so I'm not even going to bother. So now when we move that around, you can see because the head bone is influencing the neck area anyway, it is still distorting the neck, which is fine for our purposes. And just to check the arm, so the hand bone is not influencing anything else. If I just select rotation, you can see nothing else changes. If I select the next bone in, that one looks okay, but I select this big one and you can see we're now hitting more vertices. Part of that is because we haven't got a lot of vertices in our model, but we don't need to be affecting that area at all. So we'll go to subtract again and just remove all of that. Just leave a little bit at the top there. So now when I select this one, you can see there's very little influence on anything other than the area that we wanted. So bringing our car back, that now allows us, if we move our car forward a little bit, probably even afford to widen that area a bit now. If you want to move the whole model, you'll need to move the armature and the model it's affecting together, otherwise you'll get problems. So now we can put his arm over here, I guess, and we can still reorient the bones individually just to get what we need. And if we need to move the whole arm more easily, we can add inverse kinematics, of course. There he is with his arm on the car. And you can notice when we go into edit mode, he goes back to his default position, and then we come back out of edit mode, and there he is reformed. Now, again, we've got some slight distortion here, and that's to do with the vertex mapping. So very briefly then, how do we animate him? I'll just move his arm for the moment. So at this position, we're in pose mode. I've got his hand selected and I'm going to press I and just say location rotation for the part of the model selected. I'm going to come along to perhaps frame 25. So that's a second in, and I'm going to say location rotation again. So that basically means it's going to do nothing. It's not even going to start doing anything yet, but then I'm going to go 50 frames in. So that's now 2 seconds in. And I'm going to lift his arm up slightly, push it back a little bit, and lift his hand a little bit, and lock rot there. Now, normally you might want to copy original positions when you're doing an oscillatory movement, such as a walk cycle. But of course, we don't necessarily put our hand back in exactly the same place as where it was when after we've lifted it up. So that doesn't matter so much. So I'll come forward another 25 seconds and put it back roughly where it was, and press I and store location rotation. So if we go back to the beginning and play that, we can see he's rotating his hand. Now we only stored, what I should have said is we've only stored the position of that one bone. If we wanted to move more of his arm, what we should have done is actually stored whole character, or at least selected bones. He's actually stored whole character, but if we're gonna do that, what we will need to do is also do any head movements. Now I don't want them completely synchronized, so I'll set head to have location rotation set to its zero point, as it were. Then we'll come up to say 30 something and it's still location rotation at its initial point. Then 70 something and we'll rotate on the Z, location rotation. And with organic movements, unless they are repeating a lot, there can be a bit of variation in them. They don't have to be perfect. So let's see what that's looking like at the moment. So I've only got one little tap of his hand there, but if I now remove the layer with the armature in, now we can see what that's doing. And of course I've done this very, very roughly, but you can see his hand comes up there and it's not completely aligned with the head, which is fine. Otherwise it would look even more mechanical. So the next thing, how to create that star background. I'm going to open a new instance of Blender because this has already got it set. So I'll go to rendered view, but I'll bring up the node editor as well. And this time we'll go to the world settings. So the world has just got a black background at the moment. So I'm going to add a texture, which is a noise texture. Those of you who have watched other of my space-based tutorials will know exactly what I'm going to do now. It's just a very quick and easy way to make randomly generated stars with no seam. I'm going to take the color output because I think stars can have a little bit of color. And at the moment, I'm just going to put that straight into my background. And you can see I get this rough coloring pattern. I used about 320 for the scale. Set the detail up to the default maximum, though you can set that higher. And I left distortion at 0. Next thing we need to add is a color ramp. So I'll just drop that in there. Set it to cardinal, which gives you a sharper drop off. And select the low point be reasonably high and the high point down a little bit from that. So as you can see, as you vary these points, that will vary the amount of stars in the scene. They're all black and white at the moment for a reason, so you just get it to where you think is about right. If they're not bright enough, you can add a gamma node or double up on the stars. So that's the where the stars are. Add a color mix node, but use the output of the color ramp on the factor. Use the output of the noise texture as the second input on the mix node and set the first input to black. So although it may not be obvious, the stars actually have slightly different colors now. And then you can turn the strength up. I used about 5, and that makes the stars a bit brighter. So that now gives us a nice endless star field. Very easy to do. So having done that, we now want to add a representation for the sun. I'm going to move my sun lamp a little bit further away. Sun lamps, it doesn't really matter where they are in a scene because of the way they work, they're parallel beams. But nevertheless, for what we're going to do, I do want it to be associated with something. So I'm going to add a mesh, which is another icosphere. I'll give it a couple of subdivisions, it doesn't really matter, but we'll set it to smooth shading. All I'm going to do with that icosphere is just add a simple material, which is an emission material, left at white, but I used about a strength of 25. I also added a pass index of 1. Finally, I roughly co-located it with my sun lamp. I actually put it around it, it doesn't necessarily need to be, but I do need to come over here and turn off shadow under the settings for this mesh. So this is effectively a representation of the sun, and we can vary the size to make our sun look bigger or smaller. But what I'm going to do is select my sun, select my mesh, Control P, set parent to object, keep transform. So now when I move this mesh around, the sun will move with it. And if I rotate the mesh, the sun will rotate with it. And then finally what I did, I'm going to add a new camera at this point. So there's our camera view. And at the moment, if I just press play, the Earth stays where it is. And we can just see that small amount of animation of our character. But what we need, obviously, is a car to be rotating with, and the camera rotating with it. So here's an easy way to do that. I'm going to add an empty. So an empty is just an object that doesn't render. You can have them in various different forms, but the plane axis is the most common. And I'm going to put that roughly in the center of the car. So I want to be rotating around that point. It doesn't necessarily have to be, but that's where I'm putting it. I'm now going to select the car. We'll select the armature, the human model, the car, and the camera. And then I'm going to select the empty, Control P, say Object Keep Transform. Now, if I just select my empty, press G, I move that around or rotate it, everything rotates with it. So now all I have to do is press I and say rotation. So that stored the rotational position. If I come over to here, we can see how much we're going to rotate. I'll go to the end of the animation and say rotate X 360. You'll often get a slight problem when you do it like that, so type in 360 is probably easier, and then press I, hovering over the rotation. So if we go back to the beginning, press play, you can see the camera is rotating with the car. We of course don't want the sun and the earth to be rotating. And if we look through the camera, it looks as though everything, the car, we're all stable, everything around us is moving around us, which is what it would look like. The only thing I would say is you notice how it slowed down and then sped up again? And that's because of the default Bezier curve for the animation. So if we go to the graph editor, go to key, interpolation mode, and set it to linear. And now there won't be that speed up and slow down. It will be the same speed. And because it's 360, it'll actually smoothly go from the end of one part of the animation to the beginning of the next. So you can loop this animation endlessly and there's no obvious seam. So that's a nice handy thing to do, but you need to type in that 360 up here. Otherwise it'll just put 0 because it says, well, you've come back to the beginning. So then we'll just do one final little bit about the rendering. So I'm just going to let it come round to a point where we might get the sun in the scene. What we may need to do is to set the clipping on the camera. So it's the default is 100, especially if you've got your sun and or earth a long way away, you'll need to increase it. So let's set this to 2000. And there you can see our sun's just appeared up there. So now we've got our sun model in the scene. I'm just going to go for 50 samples and let's render that. So that's fine. We've got a bit of the earth reflecting in the side of the car there. And we've got our sun. Now, the reason that it's just done that is because I'm using my original file to show this. So I'm going to show how I created that, first of all, that glow effect and this ghosting effect here. I'm just going to show you the node setup for that. The first thing we need to remember is when we render, we need to do a material index pass. That's not selected by default. We then need to come bring up the node editor and select this point here. Don't be intimidated by all of this. I'm going to go through it a bit at a time. But to get that, to start to work on that sun, as it were, we need this ID mask. So that goes into index MA, which won't be there unless you've done this material index pass. And because I set the sun material to an index of 1, I needed ID mask set to 1. What that does is it says have a 1 or a white spot come out if that material is in the image. So that then mixes between the original image and whatever's on the other input. So I've just got black on the other input. And then I'm adding a glare node. I used fog glow with a mix of 0 and a threshold of 0.6 and a size of 9. So that's quite a large size. And then I'm also used that image. So this is just the image of the sun ball that I created. I added a blur, fast Gaussian, aspect corrected for Y, because when you blur things, if you don't correct it, they'll tend to be stretched on one axis, which you may want. But if you don't want that, then aspect correct it. And the reason for it is because I've got a wide view rather than a square view. So I used 2%. I then used an add node to add both of those together. So that just gave me the sort of glow around the sun. That went into another add node, and I took another version of that image into a glare node this time again, but with ghosts selected. So ghosts are these, which is effectively simulating light reflecting within the lens of the camera. You'll get it in your own camera if you point it at a very bright light source. Set to medium. If you set it to high, it will try to produce ghosts for much finer detail, but it will take a lot longer. And obviously with an animation, you need to be careful about how long your individual images are taking to render. So medium is fine for most purposes. I set it to 3 iterations. That affects the number of these ghosts. I set the color modulation up to 0.35. I think it's 0 by default. And that just gives you these slightly different colors, which simulates the different coatings on the lenses that are usually for anti-reflective or UV absorption and so on. Mix I left at 0, so that means you get both the original image and the modified image. And I set the threshold to 0.7, so that's where it starts to, as it were, trigger the ghosting effect. So that also went into the other side of this add node at a factor of 1. I should have said that the first one was a factor of 50%. So that means all of the glare node went in, but only 50% of the blur node went in. The output of that then went into another add node, the other side of which was our original image. So that's being used to basically control how much of all this glare effect. So if I set that down to 0, it'll take a second to process it. See, it's going here. And most of the glare effect has disappeared. There is still some because I've got some later on. So I had that to about 0.117, I think it was, something like that. And again, it'll take a few moments. So you can see just doing this little bit of post-processing does take a little while. So I then put that into another fog glow node. So this basically meant that any little bright spots, such as the reflections here, get given their own little bit of glow. A mix of minus 0.5 this time. So that meant it sort of biases towards, if I take that all the way down to minus 1, it biases towards the original image. If I take it all the way up to 1, it biases towards only showing the elements which are being given fog glow. So minus 0.5 means it's making that fog glow a little more subtle, because obviously these aren't as bright as the sun. And then to help clean the image up a little bit and make it a little bit less sharp, I added 0.3% of a blur, and then you can control the overall effect of the blur with the size down here, and I set that to 0.2. So that then went into a mix node. The other side of that mix node is black. The reason for that is because I've also got an ellipse mask here with a width of 1 and a height of 0.5. Set to mask type not, going into a blur node set at 20%. Again, I'm using relative Y correction. That controls the factor on that mix node, and that just gives us a vignette. So you can't really see it on such a dark image, but it basically just darkens the corners, which is what you would normally get with most cameras. They have less light hitting the CCD at the edges for a variety of reasons, and then obviously out to our composite output. Hopefully you found that interesting. I'm sure there'll have been different pieces in there for different people. As I mentioned, if you subscribe to my Patreon, you will have access to the original models, and I look forward to what you do with this information. Thanks a lot, and I'll see you in the next tutorial.
So I hope you found that interesting. If you did, let me know. If you enjoy these tutorials, don't forget to click like and subscribe. I also have a Facebook page and a Twitter account, and I now have a Patreon page as well. And I'll provide links to all of those in the description below. So I'll see you in the next tutorial. Thanks a lot.